Hey, it's Crypto Bobby, and today I want to talk to you about two things. The first, a tweet from Matt Odell on Mount Gox and some really interesting data from Mount Gox wallet transfers. I know we had talked yesterday about Mount Gox being potentially part of the factors as far as why the crypto market potentially dipped a little bit more than usual, in addition to the SEC and in addition to the Binance uncertainty, but some really interesting data points there from Matt Odell that I want to dive into, as well as I want to talk about five cryptocurrencies that are crypto assets, whatever you want to call them, that are holding up better than the majority of the other ones out there. And nothing is really held up very well. The only thing that's stayed steady is our good old friend Tether. So I want to talk about five cryptocurrencies that are actually, in comparison to some of the other ones, performing and holding up a little bit better than the rest of the pack. So let's dive into all of that today. One thing that I want to address first too, is I got a few comments and people kind of mentioning this, but after yesterday's video where I talked about what I thought was kind of three contributing factors to the reason that the market dipped, some fear, uncertainty, and doubt around the SEC, Binance, and Mt. Gox. A lot of people are saying, stop making videos about this. You know, why are you contributing to the FUD? You're spreading FUD, blah, blah, blah. And Ari Paul had a good tweet recently, and this is more in regards to kind of specific cryptocurrencies, but he said, don't get defensive about your favorite $500 million crypto project being criticized on Twitter. If the cryptocurrency in question can't survive Twitter FUD, it's doomed anyway. And I would think that's kind of transfers over in a lot of respects to, if there's bad news about cryptocurrency or somewhat negative news, it doesn't mean I'm not going to mention it. You know, if you want to go to a channel where everybody just talks about we're going to the moon, we're going to the moon, we're going to the moon every 5 seconds, it's not the channel for you. And I don't want to be Mr. Negative, but if something that is not potentially great comes up, but it's still noteworthy, I'm going to mention it and I'm going to talk about it. So I don't like contributing to quote unquote FUD, but I'm also not going to just shy away from stories and be a moon boy, because I don't think that adds value to anybody at all. So I just wanted to mention that and preface that as we dive into today's episode. And as we talked about yesterday, one of the things that kind of popped up was this whole deal with a Mt. Gox trustee selling $400 million worth of both Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash. And this was something where, you know, Mt. Gox recovered a lot of Bitcoin from their hacking. They, I guess, had it in a wallet. Mark Harpalis was just a total mess, and Mt. Gox was a total joke back in the day, but they still have a large holding of Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash now with the Bitcoin Cash fork that they own, and the creditors of Mt. Gox, the people who had money on Mt. Gox and who are eventually hopefully going to get that back, this was kind of part of the step for them to do that. But Matt Odell, who I follow on Twitter, good follow if you don't follow him, it's at @Matt_Odell, O-D-E-L-L, was talking about the Mt. Gox trustees and how they sold 35,000 Bitcoin. We talked about that yesterday for $362 million, 34,000 Bitcoin Cash for $45 million, according to reports coming out from the creditors. They started selling in December, ended that in February. So obviously that wasn't the cause of yesterday's dip, really, but we can pop back. So they actually, Matt and a number of other people found a list of the transfers out of their wallet, which is pretty interesting. And you could see, they sold it on exchanges, which is kind of mind-blowing. The fact that Mt. Gox, the trustees, didn't just go OTC. If you're not familiar with what OTC is, over-the-counter, doing it off of an exchange, going directly between two parties, usually how the majority of large-scale Bitcoin transactions like that take place, because the liquidity on a lot of these exchanges is not such where you can just offload $10 million of Bitcoin in a single pop. There's usually not enough buy support there. So that's one of the big interesting things with this whole sale, is that it was mostly done on exchanges and not done OTC, which is where you might expect if somebody wants to sell $400 million worth of Bitcoin, they might work with an OTC trading desk, somebody like Cumberland or some of the institutional investors out there, Gemini, some of the other ones out there like that, that might allow that to be better absorbed into the marketplace. That didn't happen. But Matt tweeted this, and then he had a, if you're listening on the podcast, I will link to the tweet and to this image. But really interesting image here where you can see this is to see the transfers of Bitcoin out of, this is to see the transfers of Bitcoin out of the Mt. Gox Trustee wallet. And you can see at the top when Bitcoin was at $19,000, they transferred $2,000 Bitcoin out of their wallet. You don't know if they sold or not, but they did sell over the course. But literally at the top of the market, at the exact peak of the market, basically, when Bitcoin was nearing $20,000, the Mt. Gox Trustee moved 2,000 Bitcoin out. And then again, when Bitcoin was at $16,000 on its way down, they transferred 6,000 Bitcoin out. And then it kind of went down all the way to $12,000, bounced back up to $17,000, and then went down again on the way down at 8,000 Bitcoin, or at $13,000. Per Bitcoin, they transferred out 8,000 Bitcoin. At 6,000, they transferred another 6,000 Bitcoin at $11,000 or so. And then literally all the way, basically at the bottom of the market, they transferred 18,000 Bitcoin when Bitcoin was at about, looks like between $8,000 and $8,000. And it kind of correlates every single, when you look at every bit of these transfers, whenever they happen, there is a pretty extended red candle following that. And it looks like they sold 18,000 Bitcoin basically at the bottom of the market when we had that massive dip all the way down to $6,000 and the subsequent rebound back up to $10,000 or $9,000 where we're at right now. So really interesting stuff. And again, I don't think anybody has the specific records. I'm sure that for the creditors, that might become public at some point in time as far as what rates that they sold that out if it's not already public. But just a really interesting thing to look at here as far as how that aligns with the downward market movement. And I'm sure that this is not the only contributing factor. But when you think about the fact that they were selling this Bitcoin on exchanges and not OTC, pretty mind-blowing to me. So that's, you know, kind of just nuts in general. But again, I will link to this below. I thought it was really fascinating to see kind of how the Bitcoin was tracked out of these wallets and to the exchanges. Now, getting to the five cryptocurrencies that have held up pretty well in comparison to Bitcoin. So as you guys know, we've been basically in a bear market since early January. Pretty much first, second week of January, it has not been good for basically any cryptocurrency out there. It's been a rough go of things. And I do think that, you know, I'm starting to get a lot more tweets and a lot more comments and emails from people that are saying, hey, so-and-so cryptocurrency is down 50%, 60%, 70%. Should I sell? Should I sell? Should I sell? What should I do? What's going on? And Crypto De Medici, who I think has a really interesting crypto or a really interesting Twitter profile, can tweet sometimes contrarian things, which are nice because it's going against the grain and it gives you just another outlook. And a lot of the things he says, I kind of tend to agree with. And this one was fun. This one I thought was funny, but also really interesting, where he said, you want to get a 10X, but you're worried over a 30% loss. What did you expect? 10X demands volatility. Right now, we are obviously in a volatile period. The volatility is going in the downward trend, not in the upward trend. This is not, unfortunately, this isn't November, December, and the first week of January, where everything is just going up 10, 15% in a day. Now, when you look at that, though, there are a lot of cryptocurrencies that have gotten whomped over that time frame. You have Ripple down 78% from the all-time high. Bitcoin Cash is down 76% from the all-time high. Cardano has just fallen off a cliff, down 83% from its all-time high. Tron is down 88%. There are a lot of cryptocurrencies that are down 60, 70, 80%. However, there are a few, not many, but there are a few, basically the best performing cryptocurrencies out there right now, the best performing cryptocurrency, at least in on-chain FX. And there are a couple other ones that are smaller in nature that are on CoinMarketCap, but just using on-chain FX for this data, Monero is actually the strongest performing cryptocurrency in terms of holding its value against the all-time high. And there are a couple different factors that are due to that. I think Monero is the privacy use case is growing, and I think people are feeling the importance of that more and more as regulation. The rumors of regulation are happening more and more. I do think that privacy is something that people are looking at and saying, well, Monero's use case is actually like This is real. I could potentially really use what's going on with Monero. Granted, Monero's down 15% on the day, so not ideal, but even with Monero down 15%, it's still only down 42% from its all-time high, which is the best performing cryptocurrency out there right now. A couple other ones of note that I would say, Omise Go, R-Chain, and both Ethereum and Ethereum Classic are holding up better than you might expect. Ethereum and Ethereum Classic, while Ethereum Classic kind of went up nicely into in anticipation of the Callisto airdrop and then sold up prior to, Ethereum Classic's actually recovering a little bit today, so something to keep an eye out on. But Ethereum and Ethereum Classic are both down about 50% from the all-time high, and then R-Chain as well as OMG and Litecoin and Neo have all held up in a really nice manner. But out of the five, I'm seeing from just in my mind that are kind of showing some nice strength. Monero, while it's down nicely today, down pretty substantially today, Monero has obviously shown strength recently. And if that Ledger integration, if that Ledger access, if you are able to store Monero on a Ledger, which rumor has it that's happening sooner rather than later, I do think that is going to do quite a bit in terms of the usability and accessibility of people storing Monero, because I don't think that many newbies are comfortable storing Monero with kind of the desktop wallet or some of the other available solutions at this point in time. But OMG and R-Chain are also two that I'm looking at that you might think, you know, they are, neither of them are R-Chain is definitely a smaller cryptocurrency, about $500 million in comparison to some of the other ones. R-Chain is smaller and it's held up pretty well. And I do have a small position in R-Chain, but it is something that I am looking at as potentially kind of increasing that holding in, just because it has been able to hold up much better than a majority of the other platforms out there, like a Cardano or like a NEM or like an EOS in some cases. So there have been a number of and a platform plays that haven't really performed that well. That's been kind of one of the weaker points of the market right now. Decentralized exchanges have also taken a massive hit. But R-Chain has been looking pretty appealing there. And then Ethereum and Ethereum Classic. Well, I think a lot of the news about ICOs and basically the regulation about ICOs is maybe not super, super positive for Ethereum and Ethereum Classic. They've both been making some pretty nice headway in terms of just development and kind of moving their platforms along. I think the competition amongst other platforms has really been making Ethereum and Ethereum Classic both kind of rise to the occasion a little bit. So it's been exciting to see kind of how those ones have been moving along. But in my mind, kind of the five that, like I said, have been showing strength, Monero, OMG, R-Chain, Ethereum and Ethereum Classic have been performing fairly nicely in comparison to the other ones. Granted, you're still down 50% from the all-time high, but when you look back, depending upon where you got into the market, that's one of the big things, is kind of zooming out your vision, at least in my mind. Somebody tweeted out, I think it was Empty Beer Bottle on Twitter, tweeted out today, are you wrecked or not wrecked? And I tweeted, wrecked in comparison to the first week of January, rich in comparison to August. And I think that's true for a lot of people. Granted, if you got in December or early January, you're probably pretty wrecked. And it's hurting and it's not fun. And this bear market can likely go on for quite some time. However, I've been in scenarios where I got into cryptocurrency literally at the top in December 2013, January 2014, where the crypto markets went from $1 billion to $15 billion, basically back to about $2 billion in market capitalization. And a lot of people lost interest. A lot of people stopped kind of continually investing in dollar cost averaging because they lost confidence. I'm not going to do that. I'm more and more confident in the technological advances and the teams that are working and the talent that is working in this industry on a day-by-day basis. And yes, regulatory stuff is coming out that might not be great. There's a lot of uncertainties around that. But I'm excited to kind of continue to watch this space. I'm prepared. I'm mentally prepared for a longer bear market if that happens. But what I know will happen for me personally is if that if If this bear market continues, I'm going to stick around. I'm going to continue to dollar cost average. And one day, whether it's in a month or 6 months, a year, 2 years, whatever it might be, when that next bull market comes, I'm going to be prepared and I'm going to be ready to go. And I'm going to have positions and assets that I feel very comfortable about. So that's kind of the way I'm approaching things at this point in time. But hopefully this video was helpful for you. If you have any questions, I would love to hear your comments below in the YouTube comments. Or if you're listening on the podcast, hit me up with a rating and a review. That would be fantastic. Thank you so much for your time. Crypto Bobby signing out. Have a good one. Peace.